Bloodlines of the Illuminati. By Fritz Springmeier. Continued. Questioning old assumptions. There was enough circumstantial evidence to lead one to question several assumptions. I began to question the assumption that the WT presidents were unconnected to each other. Another supposition that was questionable was that the WT society did not have a hidden agenda. C.T. Russell's story. Once there was a Jewish family whose name was Russell. They lived in early 17th century Germany. They moved to a country called Scotland. There they respelled the name Russell. They took on the ways of their new homeland. The English tried to settle Protestants from Scotland in Ireland in order to control the Irish. When the opportunity opened up to go to the Emerald Island, Ireland, with the Scottish settlers who went to the plantation Ulster, they went. It is possible, but not known for sure, that they learned to know the Rutherfords either in Scotland or Ireland. Scotland repeatedly appears as the source of much of the religious heresy connected with the power. That C.T. Russell's family were in Scotland for a period, and also from the German states, which seemed to be a hotbed for Jewish Satanism, may be only a coincidence, and then again it might be a clue to understanding the origin of the Watchtower Society. This author's previous book, The Watchtower and the Masons, tells the story how the Arian heresy began at the University of Edinburgh, Scotland, and spread to the Presbyterians of the Synod of Ulster. The book gives this author's reasons for believing that the C.T. Russell's family in Northern Ireland were Arian in belief before coming to the US, and chances are they were involved with Freemasonry also. The Ackley connection. In The Watchtower and the Masons, the early history of C.T. Russell is given. Charles and his father married two Ackley sisters a number of years after Charles's mother died. What is an intriguing item is that C.T. Russell's mother's will indicates she owned land in Iowa. A description of that land shows it was north of the town of Ackley, Iowa. It turns out that a man named William Ackley had purchased the land in that area, and had sold it in large part to Scot-Irish settlers of the Presbyterian faith as they were coming to America. At the time C.T. Russell's mother died, a town named Ackley had been staked out in 1857, but the Civil War had interfered with construction plans. A Presbyterian congregation had been formed in the area during the early 1860s in the Ackley area, which indicates some settlers had arrived. What connection did the Russells have with the Ackleys years before Charles T. and his father married Ackley sisters? Who are the Ackleys? Maria Ackley, who was Charles T. Russell's wife, was well educated and an excellent writer. Interestingly, in the 19th century she believed a socialist revolution was coming. She wrote, "This great revolution has not yet come, but where is the statesman or the intelligent citizen that does not see it coming?" Russell. Maria. This Gospel of the Kingdom, page 26. She was the ghost writer and ghost editor for much of her husband Charles T.'s work. Her family was well off. William Ackley, the land speculator slash seller in Iowa, traces his ancestry back to Prince Don and Elizabeth Godfrey. Elizabeth Godfrey in turn was the great-granddaughter of William Brewster of the Mayflower fame. The Ackleys were Puritans to begin with and seem to have been concentrated in the Connecticut area, and from there their family members moved out into New York and PA. Another Ackley, 1832-1881, at that time was Richard Thomas Ackley, a Freemason who worked for the Miller, Russell, and Company store in Salt Lake City in 1858, soon after the Mormons built Salt Lake City. Leads. Of course, these are all simply tantalizing leads for the investigator, but nothing solid. There seems to be much more to Charles T.'s Russell than the little that the public has been told. In the next few chapters we will attempt to dispel some of the mystery surrounding the man. God's anoint seed. In 1852, the Joseph Little Russell family had a baby who they gave the same name to as his uncle had. This baby, named Charles T.'s Russell, had a brother Frank who was 2 years older, but Charles ended up the favorite of his father. Later Charles would get a sister Margaret M. Both Charles T. and his sister Margaret spoke on various occasions that his had been chosen before his birth for the work that he was to carry out. Point 1. Margaret referred to her brother as the greatest man alive, a giant unmatched. She stated that he had been chosen for his religious work before his birth. Perhaps, Charles's Russell family, and his father Joseph L., like Joseph Kennedy, who had goals for his son to be president, had goals for Charles. If Charles had been encouraged to meet such expectations and had gone forward, then that could account for his sister's great admiration for him. He had fulfilled her father's wishes. At the Put-in-Bay convention, his sister Margaret had outlined how God planned and chose her brother. First, God had planted a seed with the early church. But the seed had laid dormant for centuries. In due time, she says, the seed of truth grew and was watered according to God's plan. During the Dark Ages, the seed of truth was barely kept alive, waiting for God's chosen one to bring it to fruition. When it was time, God anointed the eyes of her brother at age 17, and God's smile of favor rested upon him. Margaret said her brother was the one, the faithful one who God could depend upon, the one despite the burden and heat of the day would remain faithful to God. Point 2. Notes. 1. C.T. Russell is noted to have privately admitted his belief that he was chosen for his great work before his birth. The Finished Mystery. The Watchtower Bible and Tract SOC 1917, page 53. A testimony speech given by his sister at the Put-in-Bay Convention where she said similar things is commented on the Laodicean Messenger, pages 179-180. 2. The Laodicean Messenger, pages 179-180. The Illuminati Security System. Russell Trust is the legal corporation that is the order of the skull and bones, financed the creation of host of security company under the Wackenhuts, including a security service called Wackenhut Corporation. Another part of this is Wackenhut World Technologies, Inc., or WWT Inc. Wackenhut operates worldwide. Their headquarters are in Florida. They have branch offices even in places like Portland, Oregon. Wackenhut handles all intelligence-related and super-secret work classified ultra for the U.S. worldwide. They are the ones who guard the UFO bases topside, along with the CIA's Delta teams, and various MP units, etc. Their branch in Las Vegas provides security for the Groom Lake UFO facility. Las Vegas Review Journal on Friday, July 26, 91, page A1 and 3A had an article about three Wackenhut agents who lost their lives in a helicopter crash near the Groom Lake. The telephone number to Wackenhut World Technologies connects first through the Russell Trust. It is 702-646-4406, and it will be answered by the Russell Trust. Wackenhut's board of directors are CIA, FBI DIV5, NSA, ISA, and NRO officials. The girls who answer the various local Wackenhut Corporation numbers are not in the know about what Wackenhut WDTECH are all about. Their 1-800 number is 929-2431. Their San Remave, Cyril Gables, Florida, 33146 number was 305-666-5656. Their local number here is 256-3996, and one of their local CA number is 714-979-4966. George Russell Wackenhut is their security services executive. He is also the CHRM and chief executive officer. He worked for the FBI, and is a Christian Scientist. Richard Russell Wackenhut is the president and chief operator. Officer. Wackenhut has in the neighborhood of 40,000 employees. Moriah and the Mormon leadership. The top 13 families and the Mormon leadership. Rather than having an article this time about an individual family, and we will return later to our articles on the 13 top families, Lord willing, this article is an article about the 13 families in general. Content. In the first part of this article we will deal with actual people. In the second part of this article, we will discuss some about the top secret inner workings of the satanic religion that the top 13 Illuminati families participate in. Part 1. One of the THLNP that the Illuminati has done is instill apathy in people toward resisting their wickedness. A letter by an ex-Mormon says it better than I could. There are many reasons why these people, Mormons, will not come forth even though they know of the corruption in the Mormon Church. One is due to their belief in Mormon scripture, which they associate with the Mormon Church. The leadership has usurped power and authority over the scripture. Thus, the members of the Mormon Church think that God expects them to support their misguided leaders. This is much the rationalization that many Americans make about our government. They all know of the corruption, but rationalize that it is unpatriotic to talk against the government or ungrateful to complain when they enjoy superficial prosperity. It is interesting that this Mormon recognizes that the process of the common man's reaction is the same to both Mormon and American leadership, because as we will discuss, the top leadership in both, the reader will learn they are related to each other and both under the control of the top 1.3 Illuminati families. The Mormon leaders and the 1/3th top Illuminati bloodline. The Mormon president Ezra Taft Benson, considered a prophet by Mormons, was a fan of the John Birch Society. Most people who have not read my exposes on both the Mormon Church and the John Birch Society will not be able to protect themselves from the Illuminati. I don't expose these organizations without a great deal of proof. I say this because I know from too many sources and too many angles that both organizations were initiated and have been run by the Illuminati. The Mormon Church has long professed that they would defend the U.S. Constitution in the last days. They are moving to fulfill that with men like Bogritz, who sprinkles his talks with buzzwords from Mormon prophecy. The John Birch Society was part of the process of the Hegelian dialectics of the Cold War. They pretend to be the defenders of the people against the New World Order, but they are fake opposition. I have met quite a few John Birchers, and so far, although they claim to be against the New World Order, they want nothing to do with me, or to learn anything one might share with them. I can understand the leadership doing this to me, but somehow the rank and file have picked up on some of the attitudes of the leadership. I don't know how the JBS has managed to do that, but the antagonistic attitudes that they have instilled in their people toward people like myself are amazing. In my Be Wise as Serpents book, I gave the genealogical evidence to show that the Mormon leadership connected to the 13th top Illuminati family, the holy bloodline of what purports to be Jesus's lineage. I've also showed numerous other connections between the Mormon leaders and the elite Illuminati bloodlines. Ezra Taft Benson's genealogy helps tie together some of the various parts of the Illuminati beast. The Taft is Hewson's name is because Ezra Taft Benson is a descendant of Alfonso Taft, who along with one of the Russell family, Russells are one of the top 13 families, William I. L. Russell, started the Order of the Skull and Bones, legally it has been known as Russell Trust. Remember, that George Bush was a skull and bonesman. George Bush also is a descendant of the 13th top Illuminati family, the family that ties in with British royalty and the Merovingians. The man who just beat George Bush in the presidential race, William Jefferson Blythe Clinton, is a descendant of some Russells. President Clinton. This newsletter hasn't gotten to an individual article on the Russell family, but they go way back in the Illuminati. The Russells are responsible for starting the Skull and Bones Order, the Pilgrim Society, the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society, and the Masonic Daughters of Isabella, Doit. Archibald D. Russell, 1811-1871, a Mason from Scotian, set up still other organizations. Scotland has played a key role in the Illuminati. One example of thousands is Mariner S. Ecclesiastes, Government of the Fed. Reserve Board and supporter of FDR, who is member of the wealthy Mormon Illuminati Ecclesiastes family which came over from Scotland. The Russells played a key role in the opium trade in the early 1800s and early Mormonism. One of the Russell business partners was Warren Delano, Jr., chief of Russell & Company operations in Canton, China. Delano was the grandfather of Pres. Franklin Roosevelt. The Russell & Company logo was a skull and bones. The Taft family, which is also related to George Bush by blood, and the Harriman family are two families that have been intimately connected to the Skull and Bones Order, which is an entry point into the Illuminati and on the surface just an exclusive fraternity. Note, since this was written, Bogritz and the Mormon Church have gone separate ways. Bogritz, under the direction of his CIA handier, has been moving around talking to patriots, and establishing a community called Almost Heaven near Kamaya, ID. Fritz's newsletters have had several articles about Bogritz, including one entitled SPIKE, which is what Bo calls the training he is giving people. The Harriman family is also very prominent in press. Bill Clinton's life. Avril Harriman I was the CEO of George Bush's father's company. Avril Harriman's wife was Pamela, who has played an extremely important part in Bill Clinton's life. Pamela Harriman raised more money for the Democratic Party than any other single person, Newsweek, May 15, 1987. She created a political action committee nicknamed PAMPAC. When Bill Clinton lost his race for governor, Pamela made Bib Clinton head, chairman, of her PAMPAC. It took Brian Quigg, a Christian researcher like myself, to expose the connections between Bill Clinton and Pamela Harriman. Can you guess why the establishment media somehow carefully kept their relationship secret? When Bill Clinton was a high schooler, he shook hands with President John F. Kennedy, a member of one of the top 13 Illuminati bloodlines. See May 15, 93 newsletter. The master of ceremonies at the affair where JFK and Clinton met was Winthrop Rockefeller, another member of a top 13 Illuminati family, and at the time governor of New York. In the film clips of this event, which the establishment media have used recently, the establishment media edited out Winthrop Rockefeller from the scenes of Clinton and JFK. Now, why do you think they did that? The Astor family, one of the top 13 families, was intimately connected to the creation of the Rhodes Scholarship. See January 1, 93 newsletter on the Astor family. Clinton was a Rhodes Scholar and looked up to Professor Carol Quigley, the archivist of the CFR, as a mentor. The Quigley-Clinton connection introduces more connections between Clinton and the Illuminati. Quigley sidetracked people by making people think the elite were Anglophiles who wanted the British to rule the world. Although the elite are partial to the English language as a lingua franca, in their heart their allegiance is not to Britain but to Satan. Clinton has been compared to JFK and FDR by people, perhaps in a negative sense the comparison is appropriate. Let's review some of the items which stuck out as red flags to me about Bill Clinton. Several ex-witches, now Christians, identified Clinton's running mate Al Gore as switch. Al Gore's book promotes several witchcraft themes such as Mother Gain worship. Senator Al Gore has intimately worked with other men who are Illuminati for years. Al Gore was close friends with Armand Hammer, the Illuminati courier who shuttled back and forth between Moscow and America on a regular basis, and had homes in both countries. Hammer bankrolled both Al Gore, Jr. and his father Al Gore, Sr. Al Gore and Bill Clinton raised their hands at the Democratic National Convention and declared that their administration would be the new covenant. Bill Clinton's brother ended up in prison in connection to the illegal drug trade that I know that Bill Clinton was also involved with helping while he was governor of Arkansas. Readers of this newsletter are aware that the top Illuminati families are the power behind the drug trade. See previous newsletter March 1, 93, page 19 about some of Bill's role in Arkansas with the drug trade. Bill Clinton's chief campaign advisor James Carville is pictured in People's Magazine. PAGE 50, wearing a pentagram in the middle of his forehead. Bill Clinton calls his first press conference as president. Elect according to the astrologically correct full moon day. Bill Clinton in his inaugural speech said, "This ceremony is held in the depth of winter. But, by the words we speak and the faces we show the world, we force the spring." Clinton repeated the words "we force the spring" later in the speech. That expression is a very unusual expression. To force the spring is witchcraft language. In witchcraft and Satanism, Lucifer, Baal, rises from the underworld on May 1, also known by the following list of names: Beltane, a major European holiday, Communism, and the Illuminati's chief holiday, and Valpurgis. The May 1 rising brings forth the season of fertility, which the witches each year take credit for, by claiming that their magic rituals force the spring. The ritual magic that forces the spring is done on three Sabbats. The first is Imbolg, also known by names, Candy Emas by the Catholics and Groundhog Day by common dupes. The second is the vernal equinox, March 20th, in which blood and sex rituals are carried out, and the third is Beltane, May 1st, in which fire festivals are done. This is one of the fire festivals which people around the United States tell me they have witnessed from a distance. Witches believe that on May 1st, the female force completes her takeover from the male force. There are 12 cabinet members which, when they assemble with their head Bill Clinton, make the number 13. Bill Clinton chooses to force the spring with his cabinet coven. In true witchcraft tradition, the cabinet of Bill Clinton followed the pattern of forcing the spring. In order for the female to overtake the male force, Clinton chose the position of Attorney General. The title general has a male connotation. All the rest of the cabinet members are called secretaries, which has a female connotation. The Attorney General position was to be given to a woman. But in order for the witchcraft ceremony and timing to be right, the woman couldn't take over until after February 2nd, or Imbolg, and there had to be three female candidates, from which one is traditionally picked by a witchcraft coven. This is why the selection of the Attorney General was not confirmed until February 2nd. And sure enough, all three candidates given by Bill Clinton were women, from which one was selected. Bill Clinton did indeed force the spring. Further, Clinton gave told us how he would force the spring in his inaugural speech. On the 666th word of his inauguration speech, Clinton launched into a sentence on sacrifice. It will not be easy, it will require sacrifice. But it can be done, and done fairly, not choosing sacrifice for its own sake, but for our own sake. Clinton gave the hand signal of Satanists at the end of his speech. See previous newsletters this year. And Newsweek magazine headlined its story "New Age President Takes Office." January 25, 93, that Clinton would consider his cabinet a coven is not so far-fetched. Most of his cabinet tie in closely with the Illuminati. The Council on Foreign Relations is an upper level of the visible arm of the Illuminati. The January 93 newsletter explained that the CFR was the equivalent of the 4 degree of the Bavarian Illuminati. Note, that many of these people do not realize the full satanic implications of what they are in. If one reviews the various levels of the Bavarian Illuminati, you will realize that the process of corruption was gradual, and that the lower levels had no idea what they were really involved in, although some probably suspected what they were into. The basic ingredient of the lower levels is loyalty to their superiors, because they believe they are in the elite's organization. Consider, Clinton and his cabinet, Slick Willie Clinton CFRTC, Trilateral Commission, BLDRBGR, Bilderberger participant, participant in various Illuminati front organizations such as DLC, Rhodes Scholar, wife Hillary is known to practice shamanism witchcraft. Treasury Secretary, Lloyd Benson BLDRBGR, ex-CFR, connected to Sandel scandal, henchman for the Illuminati. Secretary of Health and Human Services Donna Shalala, CFR, TC, close friend of Hillary Clinton. Secretary of Defense Leigh Aspin CFR, socialist Leigh Aspin chose for his top assistant the pro-communist Jew Morton Halperin. Halperin was also a director of the ACLU, and worked loyally for Henry Kissinger at the National Security Council. Secretary of State Warren Christopher CFR. Secretary of the Interior, Bruce Babbitt CFR, he has been involved in various activities for the elite. Secretary of Labor Robert Reich, a Zionist Jew, over 50% of Clinton's major appointees were Zionist Jews, strange considering Jews only make up 2% of the population. Attorney General Janet Reno, murderer of innocent people at Waco, TX. The people at Waco believed that they were the true Jews and flew the Jewish flag at Waco. Notice that Reno, who is Jewish and was on the board of directors of the Jewish Illuminati terrorist organization of the Anti-Defamation League, could not stand the idea of Christians believing that they are the true Jews. Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, Henry Cisveros, CFR. Secretary of Education, Richard W. Riley, participant at Renaissance Weekend. I think the readers get the picture. I had a list of which ones were known to be gay, but I can't find it. A number of Clinton's high appointees are homosexuals. There is a high correlation between homosexuality and the occult, and also a big correlation between the type of Jews Clinton has chosen and Satanism. Historically, some of the most rabid anti-Christians are Satanists from Jewish backgrounds. During the inauguration week, witches, homosexuals, and homosexual witches gathered at the White House for various celebrations, to perform, to hold rituals, and other events. These people were invited by the president for various things. Clearly, those who are known publicly as a witch or a homosexual are considered honorable by the president. What is the spiritual significance of the Clintons? The answer to this can be found in my very first newsletter back in 1992. Whenever YHVH God has raised up prophets, like Elijah, to turn the people back to God and morality, Satan has sent out the Jezebel spirit. Along with the Jezebel spirit goes the Ahab spirit. Hillary and Bill fit the Jezebel and Ahab spirit exactly. I remember personally when I heard several prophets of God warn about the Jezebel spirit. I thought this sounds rather strange. I had never heard about it before. Soon I began telling people in the church I was attending about the NWO and to function in a small way prophetically, and the Jezebel spirit came into that church. The church had been happy with their elders, but after I began to warn the people about the NWO, a constant clamor was heard every Sunday for the church to select women as elders. This church had a long history without believing in women elders, and it had never been an issue. Unless one is aware of the connection between the Jezebel spirit and the Elijah type of prophet, and knows the full orb of what the Jezebel spirit is, it is not likely that a person would notice the connection between the two. Baal worship was simply an ancient form of Satanism. Jezebel was the daughter of King Ethbaal of Tyre, who was an ardent Baal worshipper. Jezebel was a satanic high priestess, a real witch. She had 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the groves. She put the true ministers of God to death. Her husband used his political office as she directed to further the power of darkness. We are simply now seeing history repeat itself. Part 2. In this part we will explain sealing rituals. I am doing this so that Christians can understand who a keeper of seals is, and also so that Christians can understand that Mormonism is closer to Satanism than it is to Christianity. This article will hopefully provide a written record so that Christians have an objective way to determine if someone who claims to be an ex-Satanist really is. I realize that some Christians don't like to learn about their enemy, and that is fine if they do not want to read this. On the other hand, I see people who are coming out of Satanism who the Christians are disbelieving. The Christians have no reference from which to determine whether someone is legitimate or not. And although I believe the Spirit of God is an excellent revealer of men, I have to be frank, even the best of Christians sometimes don't hear what the Spirit has to say, and could benefit from a written explanation. The closest descriptions of sealing rituals that I have found that matches the descriptions of satanic hierarchy rituals from people who have come out of the satanic hierarchy are the Mormon sealing rituals. For anyone wanting to do a study about how Mormonism is witchcraft, I suggest they read the Scholarii book written by a Mormon scholar, Early Mormonism and the Magic Worldview by D. Michael Quinn. Quinn conclusively shows that early Mormonism was based on magic and witchcraft. Quinn, who is a Mormon in good standing, tries to point out in the book that these things can't be held against Mormonism because most everyone back in the early 1800s practiced magic and witchcraft. Whether most people did or not, seems to me to be irrelevant as to whether it is okay. Another great book showing the connections between the Mormon temple ceremonies, witchcraft rituals, and Masonic rituals is Bill Schnobelin's book Mormonism Temple of Doom. Bill does an excellent job of showing and illustrating how the Mormon temple ceremony, Masonic, and witchcraft rituals are simply the very same thing, with minor variations. One of the most important things in Satanism is sealing. Everything is sealed. One doesn't hear the term sealing used a lot. I have read many books of the enemy to know how he thinks, and it is rare to have someone mention sealing. I had to learn about it from ex-Satanists. If one leaves off studying Satanism and begins studying the many cults and religions, one begins hearing about sealing again when one gets to Mormonism. Mormon men and women, contrary to LK 2035, are sealed to each other in the Mormon temple marriages. The early Mormons were sealed to many spouses. The Mormon sealing is very similar to what is done in witchcraft called hand fasting, and it is also similar to marriage sealing in Satanism. Joseph Smith, whose family practiced witchcraft, had many types of seals around their house which were used in magic. According to a magic book of 1830, Demonology and Witchcraft by Walter Scott, pages 165, 220-221, seer stones were to be anointed with oil, and sealed with holy characters. In 1837, Mormon leaders performed such a magical sealing for James Cone Brewster. Mormonism and the Magic Worldview. Page 209-210, Joseph Smith had a cane with a serpent on the top of it, and astrological seals below. Magic staff or canes are important in Satanism. The seal of Mars was carved on the Smith family athame, which was used by the family to draw circles for magic incantations. Mormonism and the Magic Worldview, page 142. In 1835, a ritual done by Joseph Smith to commune with a spirit messenger is recorded by Oliver Cowdery. Joseph Smith used two seals of the earth to conjure up the spirit. Ibid, page 120, Smith's ritual was in accordance with the best occult guidebooks then the Book of Knowledge and Barrett's Magus. The 1830 edition of the Book of Mormon says that about itself their voice shall be as one that hath a familiar spirit. They shall write the things which shall be done among them, and they shall be written and sealed up in a book. 2 Nephi 26:14-17. The Mormon scholar Quinn writes, the Book of Mormon's use of the word sealed also suggested a magic context. Isaiah 29 uses the word sealed only twice, but the Book of Mormon's commentary on the chapter uses sealed 11 times in 8 verses, 2 Nephi 26:17, 2 Nephi 27:7-8. Throughout the entire text, the Book of Mormon refers to itself with the word sealed or seal more than 20 times. Modern Mormons have often pictured a physical seal. But the Book of Mormon nowhere describes a physical seal, evoking instead the seal as a non-material restriction, for the book shall be sealed by the power of God. 2 Nephi 27:10, Quinn goes on to describe more about the magical sealing of the Book of Mormon. 33 A Masonic leader Manly Page Hale in his book on Masonic Symbolop describes a seal involved with black magic and the pact that is made with a conjured demon in a section entitled Modus Operandi for the Invocation of Spirits on page CIII. Within both the generational satanic covens and the covens made up of recruits to Satanism there is the office of Keeper of Seals. The keepers of seals show the importance of sealing to Satanism. Almost everything done in Satanism involves sealing. There are many vows that are made, and there are always exchanges made during these vows and then a sealing. In the exchanges there is always something lost by each person. Satanic hierarchy individuals are sealed to others, and the part of a Satanist that is put into another is magically infused. In one ritual, there is a black stone with the Satanist's name written on it that is given to the Queen Mother. See the chart January 1, 93 newsletter to understand this high rank. By giving something of oneself, that item supposedly gives magical power to the person you have vowed before. If you break your vow, they can take the item you have given and work destructive magic against you. In the satanic hierarchy, they have a moonchild ceremony where they demonize the fetus while in the womb. In the Antichrist ceremony, the item that is exchanged with Satan for a woman's vow to Satan is to sacrifice her child. Then of course this vow is sealed. The keepers of seals hold the books full of written pacts, and the items exchanged in all these countless rituals. Does the satanic hierarchy have Tesla's invention? A mother of light said, Power is a transitory experience. It is very conditioned upon the myths you are in. It is important that the person knows the myth he is in. He must have a feeling for it. The tangible can become the intangible. I'll leave the reader puzzled. How I got this quote from a mother of light, but the idea of the tangible becoming the intangible is an interesting idea, because of two reasons. First, the United States Navy is reported to have found out in World War II in the Philadelphia experiment how to electronically make a force field around something that makes the object invisible. However, the experiment proved to be very dangerous, and it took them years before the technology could be applied to something safely. This technology is being used on the stealth bomber to make them both invisible to radar and to human sight. The second reason is that an ex-Illuminati member states that an experimental box the size of a breadbox with controls was being used by the coven to make people invisible. The people had to stay where they were, they could not move around, but they were somehow made invisible by the box where they were standing. Likewise, those who want to believe that Clinton is a nice guy, that he isn't working as a lackey of the Illuminati, go ahead and believe these lies. God will even send you a strong delusion to allow you to believe these lies. But those who love the truth, and are tired of being lied to, and want answers as to why things are happening like they are will not accept the surface explanations that cover the debauchery of Satanists. Instead of getting upset that someone like myself is showing you the double meaning behind Clinton's hand signal, people should be upset that an attempt was made to trick them by Clinton. The Christian people have been told by several Christians, and I could name names but I won't, that Clinton is going to lead this nation into righteousness. God's people perish for lack of knowledge. The fact is that if Clinton really came to Christ, and really began leading the people toward righteousness, which he doesn't even now lead the people who put him in office do the real leading, then the hierarchy would kill him. Christians are always saying we need to pray for our leaders. Fine, pray for them, they need to find God, just realize Clinton is not one of our real leaders, he is way down on the totem pole and is simply a shoeshine boy for the hierarchy. Maybe the Christian people ought to learn who really leads them so they can pray better. Bush was a heavyweight for the Illuminati, and he was picked by the Illuminati originally as their first choice to win. That was before the primaries. Of course, all the final presidential candidates, Bush, Parrott, and Clinton, and maybe some of the others too, were Illuminati men. It was a choice on their part who they wanted. Bush apparently antagonized the Rothschilds, and Clinton was placed into power to appease those who were upset with Bush. That the elite decided to change from Bush to Clinton became visible in September, and in October I notified my readers that the change of choice had occurred. Supposedly Bush had mishandled something that hurt the Rothschilds financially, but whatever happened, it is clear that behind the scenes some big events happened. Clinton was close friends of Winthrop Rockefeller when he moved to Arkansas. Winthrop Rockefeller gave Clinton over $1 million. In return, Clinton was in his pocket. It has been well worth Clinton's time to serve the Illuminati kings. So good in fact that Ace Hayes may be correct when he claims that he has information showing that Clinton owns $1.2 billion in treasury bonds. If so, then it is understandable that Clinton would want taxes collected. I had hoped that my photo of Clinton giving the satanic signal at the inauguration would be finished by now. It isn't, but I will go ahead with this article. Since coming out with my March 15th, 93 newsletter, I have found out that Texi Mars came out with a photo showing Clinton's satanic signaling at the inauguration. People need to spiritually discern what Clinton is all about. Clinton gave a speech before becoming president that insiders would have no place in his administration. If people study the situation, he appointments have all been insiders. This is just one example of many that show that the words Clinton speaks are simply the words that the American people want to hear. Slick Willie is an appropriate name, for this president has absolutely no integrity nor honesty. And yet I am hearing people in the churches that want to believe in Clinton. It's sad to say they want this, because God will send them a strong delusion to believe the lies they want to believe in. Federico Pena is our new Clinton-appointed Secretary of Transportation. If he treats the country like he treated Denver, watch out. Pina got the new Denver International Airport project continued against all logic. John Coleman's WIR brings out in his newsletter the details about how Pena's airport project and many other projects he sponsored are white elephants that are not what the public needs, but simply white elephants that help line the pockets of the rich. Those of you who don't take Teximar's newsletter may find it interesting that Bill Clinton has ties to the Jesuits. Of course, I take it for granted that people realize that Carol Quigley was Clinton's mentor. Carol Quigley was one of those intellectuals like H.G. Wells who believed in a new world order and the elite that wanted to bring it in. Let me digress, and discuss men like H.G. Wells and Carol Quigley. These men believed that the West should lead the world into a new world order. I suggest that people should read H.G. Wells' book The New World Order, 1940, and his The Open Conspiracy, 1928. Another good book to understand what the elite have planned is Manly Page Hall's book Facing the Future. Oswald Spengler also has a good book to read, The Hour of Decision. The last few chapters of Lionel Curtis's World Order, 1939, also is good in explaining how they want a world commonwealth of states. People like Clinton were fed this type of stuff. But there is a much greater hidden agenda. Manly Page Hall, for instance, was part of Lucas Trust, as was late leader of the Scottish Rite Freemasons, as well as Rockefeller. Lucas Trust's externalization of the hierarchy tells us what the agenda is. The agenda is to externalize the satanic hierarchy, and on page 107 of Externalization of the Hierarchy it tells us who will rule the world on the earthly plane. His name is Lucifer. And on the spiritual level, Shambhala, it will be the Lord of the World, Sanat. We Christians know the Lord of the World not as Sanat but as Satan. It's all down in black and white on page 107. Greed and material wealth play such an important part in the lives of all these people who Satan has inspired to help dream up schemes for a new world order. Therefore, most of these people see economics as an important vehicle for creating a new world order. But there is a hidden agenda. The conspiracy is not an economic conspiracy nor a political conspiracy, but as the externalization of the hierarchy reveals in page after page, their conspiracy is a religious conspiracy. People, let's just lay it out on the line. Clinton is a Satanist, he knows what the hidden agenda is. It's an eye-opener to read the books I listed by Wells, Hall, and Spengler, but believe me, that stuff is just for the blind intellectuals. The real details of this new world order have been written down in detail, and they came directly from the master of evil himself, directly from Satan to his hierarchy, who copied the plans in detail. The people who will implement the new world order are men like Clinton. Men who have no moral code. Men who will glibly tell one lie after another. They won't implement H.G. Wells' plan, they will implement Satan's plan. And prideful Satan will unwittingly implement Yahweh God's. Bloodlines of Illuminati. Once again, I have opened up my files of research and tried to investigate the satanic hierarchy. Sometimes in doing investigation one turns down a dead end. I hope I haven't done that. There does seem to be a strong Dutch connection to the Illuminati, and the Van Dyne family might be one of the keys to understanding that Dutch connection. My investigation with Van Dyne family is the only family that has left me without any solid facts that would place them within the top 13 families. However, because bloodlines are so important to the hierarchy and because it is hard to really investigate these families without understanding their genealogies, I have made the effort to give you a genealogy of Van Dyne's that may have some importance. The Van Dyne bloodline. In 1626, Peter Minuit traded some trinkets to the Canarsie Indians to purchase Manhattan Island. The history books like to report the value of the trinkets as $24. The purchase was supposedly a good deal for the Dutch. The Canarsie Indians didn't own Manhattan Island, it belonged to other Indians, so it is debatable who got the best deal that day. That was the beginning of the Dutch colony of New Netherlands, and its capital New Amsterdam, built beside F.T. Amsterdam, all three later renamed New York. The Van Dyne family, also spelled Van Dyen, Van Dyen, etal, was one of the Dutch families to come over to the Dutch colony of New Netherlands, which was connected to the Dutch West India Company. Other early important New Netherlands families from the Netherlands include Van Cis, Van Cleef, also spelled Van Cleve and Van Cleve, Van Coorn, Van de Water, Doren, and Stuthof. In 1649, 15 years before the British took New Netherlands from the Dutch, Gerrit Cornelissen van Dyen immigrated with his older sister from Brabant, Netherlands. Brabant is a district so of Eindhoven in southern Netherlands, but at the time van Dyen came over it included Belgium, to New Amsterdam. This date is according to Claypool, Edward A. Descendants of Dennis van Dyen and Alice Tunison Chicago, IL. In contrast to this, the National Cyclopedia Volume 4, page 258 states that he came over in 1640, which is a mistake because that was his date of birth. For some reason, Gerrit Cornelius van Dyen returned to Holland to Zwolle on the east side of the Zuiderzee, although he had originally lived in Newkirk in Zeeland before going to New Netherlands, America. Gerrit C. van Dyen was a coarse, non-spiritual, ignorant man who did carpenter work. His lack of interest in Christianity seems to have carried down through quite a number of generations. After coming to the New World again, he moved away from New Amsterdam fairly quickly to New Utrecht. Now I believe that is where Greenwich Village is. In the long run, his descendants, some related to the Costello family, moved to Michigan, Illinois, Kansas, and elsewhere. In the next century, however, his descendants moved and created five branches, one in Queen's Company, New York, one in King's Company, New York, one in Dutchess Company, New York, a fourth in Somerset Company, New Jersey, and a fifth in Morris Company, New Jersey. It is possible a few other Van Dynes also immigrated from the Netherlands to America. Information on the family is scarce. In Germany, the privilege to use the title von was a special noble privilege. I believe the same applied in the Netherlands, which would mean that the Van Dynes were a prominent family when they came over. The low profile of the family didn't end when they arrived in the New World, it continues. The extremely low profile of the Van Dynes makes one wonder if they could really be one of the top 13 families. Still, Mona Van Dyen was the first woman poet laureate, a Pulitzer winner, 1991, and got a good review of her book in 1990 by the I have found that such awards take a combination of both talent and pull, especially in a field as subjective as poetry, it helps to have pull. Where did Mona Van Dyen get the political pull to get so many awards and many well-promoted poetry books? Even before the British had consolidated their hold on New Netherlands, the area was giving a foreshadowing of what it would become. Pirates which raided the East Indies and the Red Sea were outfitted in what is today New York and Rhode Island. William Patterson, born c. 1655 in Scotland, was the evil genius behind the establishment of the Bank of Engiant. It is strongly believed that he was a trader in New York in 1668-69 and that prior to this he had worked with the pirate Morgan, who operated in the New Netherlands area. Witchcraft was part of some people's lives in New Netherlands, but the colony was far more lenient toward them than in the Puritan colony in Massachusetts. The last Dutch governor of New Netherlands, Gov. Peter Stuyvesant's sister-in-law, was suspected of witchcraft, but acquitted. Ralph Hall of Seat Alcott, Long Island, and his wife were the only ones seriously tried of witchcraft in New Amsterdam, and they were acquitted. In 1687, the British had taken the New Netherlands from the Dutch for the second and final time, and they made the Dutch take an oath of allegiance to the British crown. Three Van Dynes of New Amsterdam are recorded having taken that oath. They were Gerrit Cornelis van Dyen, Cornelis Jems van Dyen, and Denegies Gerrys van Dyen. However, in the 1790 census taken in New York State, there are no Van Dyen families at all listed. One of the best books on the Van Dyen family is New Netherlands Families by Wilson V. Ledley, Volume 3, which is about the Van Dyen family. I obtained a copy of the Van Dyen part, which was able to assist me in my genealogy work. I count 378 Vandines in the fifth generation of Vandines in this country. Some of the families that the Vandines have intermarried with are Ailing, Allen, Brendel, Bullinger, Greber, Hayes, Kennedy, and Robertson. Some of the other families which are definitely Dutch with which the family married with are the Van Burens, the Van Cleves, and Van der Hoof. It would be exceedingly interesting to find out if the Vandines connect at all with the Dutch King William of Orange or some of William of Orange's supporters. Many of today's elite trace back to William of Orange or his prominent supporters. The Vandine last name has ended up with many spellings. For instance, in Bergen Company, New Jersey. The name is spelled Vandine, 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 and Vandine. An informer states that Vandine is one of the top 13 Illuminati families. If that is so, then it certainly is the least known family of the 13. This article will show clues and evidence that have kept me from rejecting the possibility that the family is indeed one of the top 13. On the other hand, there are also some very puzzling things about this family that almost disqualify it from being a top family. One puzzling thing is how rare this surname is. Considering that the name belonged to one of the earliest settlers in the New World, one would expect quite a clan to have developed. But this is not so. Another puzzling thing is that the conspiracy has a great deal of activity going on in Brussels, Belgium. Belgium is half Dutch, half French. Many of the people in Brussels have Dutch names, and it would be expected that if the Vandine family were a top family, they would have someone in Brussels, but I wasn't able to locate any there. See the reproduction of the Brussels phone book to show that some places have been named after the Vandines but none live there, although two Van Dunens are listed. Van Dunes that caught my eye. Historically, there were a few Vandines that caught my attention. Cornelis Vandine, 1709-1779, dash left an inheritance of £1,000 of money to children. William Vandine, 1695-1773, dash left two plantations to children in wool. Aaron Vandine, 1831-1899, dash trustee and deacon of the Meth Episcopal Church. Alfred Voorhees Vandine, 1843. An undertaker of Middle Bush, New Jersey. Harrison Vandine, 1845-1914, dash member of New Jersey legislature in 1879, became Speaker of the House in 1881. Scottish and York Rite Freemason, member of the Holland Society, see Holland Society Yearbook 1915, and numerous other business organizations and societies. Horace N. Vandine, stockholder in the Boston National Bank. Louis Vandine, surveyor, organizer, and president of Boonton Water Company, owned lots of real estate. Simeon Vandine, inventor, member Meth Church in Boonton. The Vandine name is known in Western United States because of Vandine chocolate candies. The Vandine name has been well known in the New York area. The oldest of the large care centers for the elderly in New York is named after a Vandine. It was founded in 1827 at Syracuse, New York, address is West Seneca Turnpike. This elderly care center, the Vandine Home and Hospital, was reported to have 537 total regular staff, 136 nurses, and 526 licensed beds, which are kept 99% occupied, making it the largest. I have very limited knowledge of the Vandine family. Three Vandines are worthy of mention at this point. One Vandine was reported by an NSA informant to have been the liaison officer between MI6, the CIA, Mossad, and the Vietnamese government during the 1960s. Another Vandine was the founder of a branch of Planned Parenthood, an important New Age group which has been promoting sterilizations, birth control, abortions, etc. for over half a century. The third is Mona Jane Vandine, who has authored several poetry books, and is a Guggenheim Fellow. Edward Seguin Vandine and Planned Parenthood. Edward S. Vandine, 1872-1955, was a prominent surgeon who was born in Syracuse, New York. He went to Princeton University and then got his MD at Syracuse University in 1897. From 1909 until 1950, he was a surgeon. During the ghastly World War I, B was in the U.S. Army Medical Corps in France, first as a major and then as a LT. Colonel Edward S. Van Dyne attended the Unitarian Church during his life, a church which has long been associated with Wicca. He also associated with the Liberal Presbyterians. In 1933, he founded the Planned Parenthood Center of Syracuse, New York. Planned Parenthood Federation of America was an Illuminati-inspired organization that was set up to accomplish several objectives. The organization's own stated purpose is very revealing: to provide leadership and making effective means of voluntary fertility regulation, including contraception, abortion, sterilization, and infertility services, available and fully accessible to all as a central element of reproductive health, stimulating and sponsoring relevant biomedical, socioeconomic, and demographic research, developing appropriate information, education, and training programs to increase knowledge about human reproduction and sexuality. Planned Parenthood Federation of America has about 190 affiliated organizations and actively promotes its agenda all over the world. It operates about 900 centers in the U.S. It maintains a 5,000-volume library on abortion, sterilization, and population control. One of its leaders, Alan F. Guttmacher, signed the Humanist Manifesto, and the president, Fay Wutlitten, was awarded Humanist of the Year in 1986. Both hate Christians. Margaret Sanger, who advocated Neo-Malthusian population controls, with money from her husband and rich backers, started the American Birth Control League, ABCL, in 1921. The ABCL opened up the Birth Control Research Bureau, BCCRB, in 1923. In 1939, the ABCL and another similar group merged to form the Birth Control Federation of America, BCFA, which in 1942 changed its name to Planned Parenthood Federation. Consider the changes that have happened within our lifetimes. In 1957, birth control devices were outlawed in all New York metropolitan hospitals. In 1969, the federal government was subsidizing abortions and birth control through the federal anti-poverty program. In the 1980s, public schools started offering condoms and new types of sex education programs for teenagers. The Schlesinger Library has been actively keeping historical records of the family planning movement, and David Kennedy wrote the book Birth Control in America, The Career of Margaret Sanger, in 1970. Much of what has happened in abortions, birth control research, and population control mechanisms has come as a result of these type of organizations. I was curious what kind of people want U.S. sterilized, our babies aborted, and the world's population reduced? What kind of people are funding the enormous amount of money it takes to get people to abort their babies? What does it cost to get a population to voluntarily neuter themselves? I randomly picked a year, 1984, to research the funding for Planned Parenthood and the Planned Parenthood branches. I was astounded at how huge the sums of money that the elite spend in just 1 year to get us to castrate ourselves and tie our tubes, and abort our babies. I have divided the list of foundations that donated money to Planned Parenthood in just the single year of 1984 into two categories. The first category are foundations that I can identify having connections to the Illuminati. The others are all the rest, and I suspect this second group has many that tie back to, I most likely haven't figured out how, Illuminati-connected foundations donating to Planned Parenthood Federation and branches and the amounts donated in 1984. Vincent Astor Foundation $150,000, Mary Duke Biddle Foundation $5,000, Dodge Foundation $115,000, the DuPonts are behind GM, Ford Foundation $200,000, McGeorge Bundy was president of Ford Found, William Randolph Hearst Foundation $10,000, Freemason Jesse H. Jones Houston Endowment $30,000, Eli Lilly and Company Foundation $10,000, Lilly Endowment $100,000. Andrew W. Mellon Foundation $970,000. Richard King Mellon Foundation $55,000. Jewish Rosicrucian, Fred Meyer Charitable Fund, $10,000. Morgan Guarantee Trust $31,000. Jesse Smith Noyes Foundation $152,400. J.N. Pugh Memorial Trust $730,000. Prudential Foundation $8,000. Kate B. Reynolds Charitable Trust $25,000. Z.S. Reynolds Foundation $30,000. Russell Sage Foundation $5,000. Max Stern Foundation $20,000. Levi Strauss Foundation $5,000. Other foundations contributing to Planned Parenthood, some of these may well also have the Illuminati behind them. Amundsen Foundation $125,600. Theodore and Beulah Beasley Foundation $100,000. Alan Bradley Foundation $15,000. Worthington Benedum Foundation $15,000. Otto Bremer Foundation $7,500. Gwendolyn Kaffritz Foundation $50,000. Lewis Calder Foundation $20,000. Champlin Foundation $25,000. Central NY Community Foundation $125,000. Charlotte Foundation $6,250. Robert Sterling Clark Foundation $200,000. Clark Foundation $15,000. Olive B. Cole Foundation $30,000. Commonwealth Fund $200,500. Dolfinger McMahon Foundation $5,000. Educational Foundation of America $50,000. OPNWE Edwards Foundation $15,000. Samuel S. Fells Fund $5,000. Field Foundation $40,000. Jebby Foundation $10,945. General Mills Foundation $15,000. Wallace Alexander Gerbode Foundation $16,000. Morris Goldsker Foundation $30,000. George Gund Foundation $108,096. Walter Haas Foundation $7,870. Ada F. Hall Charity Fund $11,000. Ewing Halsall Foundation $25,000. William Hewlett Foundation $850,000. Dayton Hudson Foundation $10,000. Humboldt Area Foundation $35,000. Jewett Foundation, of California, $12,500. Gave to IDNWA Planned Parenthood, Walter S. Johnson Foundation $147,506. Kalamazoo Foundation $32,656. J.M. Kaplan Fund $50,000. Keck Foundation $15,000. Peter Kiewit Foundation $45,000. Kranert Charitable Trust $150,000. Manzanto Fund $5,000. Medical Trust $600,000. Metropolitan Life Foundation $7,500. McCune Foundation $10,000. McGregor Foundation $5,000. McKnight Foundation $35,000. Muskegon County Community Foundation $6,000. Need More Fund $30,000. Edward John Noble Foundation $80,000. Norton Company Foundation $25,000. Packard Foundation $100,636. Pasadena Foundation $5,000. Piton Foundation $80,000. Pittsburgh Foundation $55,000. Philadelphia Foundation $23,000. Public Welfare Foundation $30,000. Ripley Memorial Foundation $5,000. San Francisco Foundation $32,209. Santa Barbara Foundation $20,000. Florence and John Schumann $25,000. William G. Selby Foundation $18,700. Skillman Foundation $30,000. Harry G. Steele Foundation $418,950. Eloise and Richard Weber Foundation $20,000. Western Electric Fund $6,000. Robert Wilson Foundation $50,000. If the reader is wondering what happened that some of the other top Illuminati families are not on the above list, The reason why is that the other families were supporting other organizations similar to Planned Parenthood Foundation, which are also working to promote sterilizations, abortions, and sexual promiscuity. For instance, the Rockefeller family runs hundreds of foundations, and just two of these, the ones named after the Rockefellers, supported the following groups in 1984, which have the same goals and agenda as Planned Parenthood Center for Population Options. Donation given $29,730, Population Council, $1,235,000, Alan Guttmacher Institute, $300,000, this is a dangerous organization doing research to promote these things, Population Institute, $10,000. On top of this, in 1984 the Red Chinese Academy of Medical Science was given several Rockefeller grants to do contraceptive, sterilization, and genetic research. One of these was a $6,647 grant given to the Red Chinese Academy of Medical Science to study male contraceptives. Has abortion, sterilization, sexual promiscuity, population control, and genetic research been part of the Illuminati's long-range plan? You bet. But it was important that the Illuminati convince the experts, at least the experts they control, that these things were needed to save mankind. Three studies were made by the elite to determine that a population explosion was threatening the Earth. According to William Cooper in Behold a Pale Horse, pages 166-67. The first was during World War II, the second at Huntsville, AL in 1957, and the third by the Club of Rome ending in 1968. All three studies concluded that population growth must be curtailed. Last year at a meeting of the elite, George Hunt obtained a handout which shows that the elite are committed to stopping the population growth by any means available. Years earlier, Illuminatus Dr. Aurelio Pecci advocated a plague similar to the Black Plague, and when the idea was developed it became the AIDS epidemic. The Illuminati have the cure for AIDS. Actually, there are many cures for AIDS, but the one they had before the AIDS epidemic began will not be given to the population until enough people die, or until the elite are exposed enough that they are forced to give out the cure. Dr. Wolf's Munis. Pope John Paul II's ex-roommate was one of the masterminds behind the AIDS epidemic. The National Security Council has had an ad hoc group on population policy to strongly encourage other nations to have birth control, abortions, and sterilizations. This group drafted the Global 2000 report, which was given to Carter. Whether the population explosion is a threat or not, having traveled worldwide and having a father who was considered one of the better agricultural scientists, I contend it is not a threat, the world's elite believe it, and they make the decisions. Further, they have a vested interest, an immoral need to believe in the overpopulation lie. Van Dine Candies. Van Dine Candies has its kitchen and administration at 739 NE Broadway, Portland, Oregon. They operate 10 retail candy stores in Portland, one in Silverdale, WA, near Bremerton. The 63-year-old company has 16 shopping mall leases and wholesales candy to other candy distributors. It also operates a subsidiary, Miss Sailor's Candies, Inc. of Long Beach, CA. Van Dine has in turn been bought out by Van Ryan Corp., 2360 Northwest Quimby St. Portland, 97,210. In 1990, American Confectionery, Inc. of Chino, CA was listed as owner of Van Dine Candies. These statistics were the ones I was able to get, they may be outdated. One informant felt that Van Dine Candies might play a role in the distribution of poisoned candy to American school children, which was an Illuminati plan on the drawing boards years ago. I contacted a Van Dine representative about any company plans to distribute candy to schools, but got no information. The company has had its share of strange things happen. Richard McCall, who was the president, borrowed $391,000 of the company's funds for his personal use. This theft of company funds was forgiven when he gave up his position and his share of stock so that he no longer had control over a large block of stock. On April 27, 1988, the Oregonian reported that the company had gone bankrupt, and had filed for bankruptcy in March 1987. However, company officials declared that the bankruptcy was merely a reorganization which involved the resolving of the equity split in financial control of the company. The Van Dyne Candies reported $10 million in sales in 1986. If they play any role in all of this or not, I cannot say. I certainly do not suggest that any of my readers boycott their candies. That would be rather rash and certainly is not what I want to see happen. Besides, because they wholesale to others, I don't know what other labels the candy gets sold under. A string of strange coincidences. A strange thing that happened to me that may be just coincidence or another piece of the puzzle. I will not mention any names, because I do not know how this all fits together. One of the men who owns two Van Dyne stores is an ex-missionary to Taiwan and a minister. This ex-missionary still is on best of terms, close friend, with the most powerful Free Chinese Army generals. He drives Cadillacs, and when he visits China is given the red carpet by his military general friend. This ex-missionary slash minister was a friend of mine, and in 1990, when he heard I had written a book, he was excited to buy my book because we were friends. When he found out the title was The Watch Hour and the Masons, he immediately lost interest in the book and never bought it. I asked him if he knew anything about the Freemasons and he said he knew absolutely nothing about them. I thought that was a strange reply, because he was a leader of the Kiwanis in this area, and I have been to his Kiwanis breakfasts which were held in the basement of a Masonic lodge here in Portland. How did this minister arrange for his Kiwanis club to meet in a Masonic lodge, yet know nothing about the Masons? Further, there are many Masons with his surname, so that at least within his extended family I would expect some of them are Masons. Later, this man's son-in-law, also a minister, called me to this son-in-law's office in a particular church and told me I should be excommunicated by Christians for trying to expose Billy Graham, even though this minister's church doesn't excommunicate. He gave me mean looks and further told me, "You will die for your sins." I don't know if this owner of Van Dyne stores has any relationship to the larger picture, or if all this is just a number of strange coincidences. I don't even know if the Van Dyne Candy Company is related in any way to the Van Dyne family, although one informant claims it is. A. Van Dyne and the CIA, MI6, Mossad, NSA, etc. MI6 was intimately involved in the creation of the CIA and Mossad. And MI6 is the guiding hand behind those two organizations. British intelligence was integrated under the title British Security Coordination, which was the world's largest and most powerful intelligence beast in the world. This beast has been under total control by the Illuminati since its beginning. Since 1940, when the BSC was set up in New York, the Americans have worked for the British. But the intelligence community in the UK, USA, Canada, Australia, NZ has gone a step beyond the secret intrigue of intelligence agencies secretly controlling other intelligence agencies. They have actually signed formal agreements which completely make all these acronym monsters into one intelligence agency. There is the Technical Cooperation Program, TTCP, and the ABCA agreement which concerns intelligence information exchange in the areas of defense research and development. The ABCA agreement concerns military intelligence. The BRUSA agreement on May 17, 1943 established exchange of personnel and the most intimate cooperation at the highest levels by the various national intelligence agencies of all. High grade comment. A secret treaty of 1947 linked all the major Commonwealth and American intelligence groups. This is just one of countless agreements, most secret, for the exchange of information. At that point in time, levels of secrecy were ultra, very secret, pearl, moderately secret, and thumb, secret. Pearl and thumb later became pinup. On February 17, 1972, a National Security Council Intelligence Directive, NSID, 6 directed the NSA to be the principal U.S. SIGINT agency, with the FBI and CIA basically working for the NSA. Although some people are claiming that there is friction between the NSA and its front organizations, the FBI and CIA, it is hard to picture that this friction is anything serious because many people in these front organizations work for the NSA. The CIA, MI6, and the Mossad all work through the BCCI, which was scandalized recently, although the elite kept the lid on the scandal. Together, the Yakuza intelligence community, or what is better termed the NWO's intelligence worldwide intelligence agency, of which MI5, MI6, CIA, NSA, FBI, NGES, RCMP, CIS, ASIO, GCHQ, NRO, DIA, and the SASB are simply departments, have together at least 300,000 people employed full-time. If there was in the 1968 time period of Andine, serving as the liaison between these various intelligence departments, he would be a very powerful man. There is a way open to me to confirm this about Van Dyne if I get the time. Two other prominent early Dutch American families. One of the men who has worked for the NWO in their think tanks and with their intelligence agencies is Professor William R. Van Cleve, who is a descendant of the New Netherlands families. His name is mentioned now because it is quite possible the Van Cleves and the Van Dynes intermarried. I know that William Van Dyne married Sarah Van Cleef in Somerset, New Jersey in around 1750. Professor Van Cleve worked for RAND, Stanford Research Institute, Department of Strategic and Defense Studies at the University of California, and was an advisor to the Pentagon, the SALT conferences, etc. The Van Cleves are said to have originated from an ancestor, Jan Van Cleef, who was the son of Dutch nobility, the last Duke of Cleves. He is said to have come to America in 1653. Two of the Van Cleves were Scottish Rite Masons in Chicago around the turn of the century. Some important connections: Collins, Whitneys, Vanderbilts. William Collins Whitney, a member of the Illuminati via the Skull and Bones Order, is someone who I suspect was part of the Collins family. The Collins family is without doubt one of the top 13 Illuminati families. William Collins Whitney was a Directory of Guarantee Trust, as well as his son, H.P. Whitney, who served later. William Collins Whitney married Flora Payne, daughter of Standard Oil's treasurer Oliver Payne. William Collins Whitney's two sons were both members in the Skull and Bones, and one of them married Gertrude Vanderbilt, another originally early Dutch American family. The money that the Whitney family had amassed from the Paynes and the Vanderbilts then was put into Guarantee Trust, J.P. Morgan, and Guggenheim. Alfred Gwynne Vanderbilt was a member of the Skull and Bones Order, in it 1899. A. Vanderbilt was sent a warning not to sail on the Lusitania, because the elite knew it was to be sunk, but he failed to get the telegram and sailed to his death. Whitman Vanderbilt was part of the group of Illuminati that made up the Round Table, in which the Satanic Astors and Satanic Cecils played a big role. I have sometimes wondered if rather than the Van Dynes that the name we should be dealing with is Vanderbilt. In any case, the point is that several of these originally Dutch families are in deep with the Illuminati. The origin of the Vanderbilt fortune is an obscure mystery. It was close to $1 billion in 1924, and must exceed numerous billions today. One reference states that Cornelius Vanderbilt, the original Vanderbilt who made it rich, made his large sums from blackmail, Minnegerode, Mead. Certain rich men. New York, G.P. Putnam's son, 1927, pp. 112-113. Lindsay Russell, of the Russell family, another top 13 Illuminati family, worked for the Vanderbilts. It was Lindsay Russell who started the Pilgrim Society, which is the sixth degree of the branch Illuminati. Lindsay Russell was also chairman of the CFR, which is the fourth degree. The Vanderbilts, the Whitneys, the Goulds, and the Rockefellers gave large sums of money to Billy Graham for his New York crusade. The Dutch connection today. Many ex-Nazis and elite industrialists have made their homes in the Garderen-Putten area of the Netherlands. The Bilderbergers are building a super hotel slash conference center near this area. One of the companies involved in building the hotel is the Nazi family of Nicanius. The Belgium-Dutch connection to the Illuminati is not trivial. The Dutch William of Orange deposed English King James II in the fighting of 1688-91. That is significant, because it appears that Illuminati financial headquarters were in Amsterdam prior to William of Orange's victory. After that victory they moved to London. One only has to note how important Brussels has been to the New World Order to realize that the lowlands of Belgium and the Netherlands continue to be important for the elite. For instance, the Beast, the supercomputer which is notified within seconds of every financial transaction you carry on at an ATM, is located in Brussels. If the Van Dyne family were indeed one of the top 13 families, it might break open some big clues to understanding THC Belgium connections and elements within the Illuminati. Earlier newsletters and the Be Wise as Serpents book have described high-level rituals carried out in a castle, Burg, in Belgium. There are Dutchmen in the genealogy of the Roosevelt presidents in the line that goes back to the British royalty. Other prominent elitists tie back to the Netherlands and Belgium also. Elizabeth Van Buren wrote The Sign of the Dove, which is a book about the Merovingians, the 13th top Illuminati bloodline, and Jesus. The book takes a Gnostic approach to religion, and puts forth the idea that the Merovingians were of extraterrestrial descent. I had expected to find the town of Dyne from which the Van Dyne would have taken their name, but none of the maps so far have shown it. I had expected to find more important Van Dynes in the Netherlands and in the US. Instead, I only found a Hitta Hendrik van Doom, who came over from the Netherlands and became a state educational official. Clearly, I have only broken the surface in trying to understand the Dutch connection in the Illuminati. Conclusions and summary. It has been theorized by others that at the top of the Illuminati are unknown superiors, so this should not scare anyone that I don't have all the details, and that the family is unknown. On the other hand, it is very hard to hide people who wield immense power. So far, I have dealt with families that were definitely within the top 13 Illuminati families. If the Van Dyne family is part of the top 13, it may represent the Dutch-Flemish-Belgium segment of the Illuminati, just as the Astors and Rothschilds came from Germany, the DuPonts from France, the Lees from China, and the Kennedys from Ireland. Actually, the entire 13 top families are related in various ways, and their heritages go back to the ancient nobility of Europe, to the tribe of Dan, and to the Hazars. Many of these top families feel they are descendants of the House of David. One researcher has even told me that the Royal House of Japan is blood relation to the 13th top Illuminati family. Truth is often stranger than fiction, but this sounds truly incredible. That would be interesting if the genealogy, which he claims does exist, does actually show that. It would help explain why Japan is being brought into the picture. I was able only to identify that the Van Dyne family was a very early colonial American family of status, and that the few modern members of this family which I could identify are suspiciously tied to the establishment and fit the type of persons we would expect from a top 13 family. If anyone has any information concerning this subject, that information would be appreciated. Revisiting the Van Dyne family, one of the top 13 Illuminati families. The Dutch-Belgium connection is one link that is very powerful in the Illuminati, but an area of which my knowledge is very scattered. I am trying to rectify that ignorance. Since my big article in the July 1, 1993 issue about the Van Dynes, I received more confirmations and tips from ex-Illuminati informants. So I have continued my search for details on the Van Dyne family. I was given the tip that the Illuminati members of this family were located in some place like Michigan, and I did indeed find that the Grand Rapids area has a large number of Van Dynes. There are also a small smattering of Van Dynes. There are a few variant spellings such as Van Duin, at Lansing, MI, North Oakland, MI, Minneapolis, Min, and St. Paul. I was also able to identify one more Van Dyne who has been part of the power structure, and might possibly then be part of the actual secret generational satanic cult activity. This man was an official for UNESCO. I have had ex-witchcraft sources tell me that UNESCO was passing NWO instructions onto them. UNESCO is one of the more directly controlled and more dangerous UN organizations. My writings have referred to it before. This man's name is Robert Gerald Van Doon. He married Florence Elizabeth Neuer. Robert Van Doon served as the associate director of the W.K. Kellogg Foundation, which is a large foundation with Ho in Battle Creek, Michigan. The Kellogg Foundation gives grants to Catholic universities, to research along the lines of Illuminati goals, and a variety of other causes. For instance, a 1984 $100,000 grant was given to the American Association of Community and Junior Colleges. The purpose? To implement a national recruitment effort to enlist the support of government and corporate leaders to improve policies concerning adult education and training. Of course, as you know, most national government and corporate leaders are part of their power structure, so of course they, the Illuminati, would like these people in the decision-making process of our junior colleges. The foundation contributed almost $10,000 in 1984 to the Battle Creek Board of Education. That should give the foundation quite a bit of clout in the local school board's decisions. Many of the grants of the Kellogg Foundation are to promote things in healthcare and agriculture, which are in the general trend of what the Illuminati is pushing for. The American government loaned Robert Van Doon to UNESCO from 1972 onwards. He was given the position of coordinator of UNESCO Service World Bank Education Project. To be in that position shows he was part of the elite, whether he was or wasn't a Satanist. UNESCO is being used to push a NWO education agenda on the world. Recently, the death of Patricia Van Cleve Lake opened up some more clues about the Van Dynes. In the July 1st article I mention on page 52 that one of the other early Dutch families in New Amsterdam which intermarried with the Van Dynes was the Van Cleves. 10 hours before Patricia Van Cleve Lake died on October 3rd, she called her son and told him the truth about who she was. The three-paragraph death notice was buried on page 14 in an Lane paper, I think the LA Times. What she told her son on her deathbed was that she was the daughter of William Randolph Hearst and movie star Marion Davies. Various people noticed her resemblance to Hearst, but dared not speak about it publicly. Her son told people after she died, she lived her life on a satin pillow. They took away her name, but they gave her everything else. Patricia was always introduced as the niece of Marion Davies, who in reality was her mother. The rumor mill since the 1920s had claimed Patricia was Hearst's daughter, but it wasn't until just this last month that it had been publicly said. The news links the Van Cleve family to Hearst. All this news is very interesting in light of several previously established facts. First, Hearst, who funded Billy Graham's first 3 years of crusades, was part of the Illuminati. Second, the Illuminati often adopt out their children to hide their paternity and ancestry. Third, the Van Cleve family is linked to the Van Dynes, which raises the possibility of links between Hearst and the Van Dynes. Follow-up article on the Van Doons. The long Van Dyne article of the July 1st, 93 newsletter indicated that I was puzzled that I hadn't found more clues about the power of the Van Dyne family, which an informant had told me was one of the top 13 Illuminati families. Since that time, I have spent time with a very knowledgeable ex-Illuminatus, and it was confirmed that the initial information was indeed correct. The Van Dynes are one of the top 13 bloodlines. Some of the satanic members of this bloodline are in the north-central area of United States, such as in Michigan. I found out that this bloodline keeps much of their money in Europe, and that they are linked to some Ldalians, the Mafia. With some more clues to pursue, I hope to discover some more about this top Illuminati family which has gone to such great lengths to be hidden. It is clear that they have kept their money and businesses well hidden, via holding companies and other gimmicks. Epilogue. This collection of articles has tried to take the reader backstage to meet the families that control the Illuminati and the world. One of the best places to see representatives of the different 13 families together are when they gather for the Feast of the Beast. The backstage story is far from being told. The Van Dyne family is a fitting way to end this book, because the mystery that surrounds them highlights the work that still remains to tell the complete story. The Van Dyne articles do not mention Roel Van Dyne of Amsterdam, Netherlands, who founded / headed in modern times the socialist / communist movement in the Netherlands. He was a powerful man. The movement was led by provocateurs, whose demonstrations at times got violent. What is the nature of the relationship between the Van Dyne family and the Van Cleve family? I know there was some intermarriage, but due to time restraints I never completed my investigation down this avenue. While Roel Van Dyne was leading his radical movement, Miss Davies' father was living at Hart's Riverside Doctor No. 336, and her brother-in-law George Van Cleve was an executive in Hearst's Film Corporation. The mystery of the Van Dyne family is also reflected in the mystery surrounding the Romanov family. The Romanov family had more than the Russian branch, there was for instance a Prussian branch. And some of their family, like the Grand Prince Alexis Romanov, came to America, where his granddaughter Mary T. Sear, the cousin to Alexander Romanov, was one of J. Paul Getty's main lovers. J. Paul Getty, if you have forgotten, was at one time listed by Fortune magazine as America's richest man. Not only does Romanov blood flow in some of the Illuminati, the Romanov name pops up among the friends of Frank Sinatra. Mike and Gloria Romanov were friends of Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra's social activities were like a who's who in the mafia and Illuminati. Frank Sinatra would travel to France to spend time with Baron Guy de Rothschild, or could be found doing a charity ball for the World Mercy Fund with Lawrence Rockefeller. Mentioning the Rockefellers brings us right back to the Romanovs. And then who was Anne-Marie Rasmussen, who married Nelson Rockefeller's son Stephen Clark Rockefeller? When one reads her book There Was Once a Time of Islands, Illusions, and Rockefellers, New York, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich, 1975, one learns that she was from Norway, a maid in the Rockefeller home, learned trademark, and was shocked by the Rockefellers' abundant primitive art of the Rockefellers. Primitive simply was a Rockefeller expression for all the nude art that they have all around. In her book, she talks about the playhouse at Kikuit, about Margareta, Happy, Rockefeller's close friend Mrs. Vincent Astor, about Lawrence Rockefeller's St. John Island, where he built the Keneal Bay Plantation, and the Rockefellers' ranch at Jackson Hole, W.Y. Talking about the Astors brings us back to Frank Sinatra, who bought Mary Astor's large rambling property in the Toluca Lake area of the San Fernando Valley. Frank bought the land without even seeing it. Frank is not the only one not seeing things. So much of what is being told us by our media is outright distortions. John D. Rockefeller, Sr. would get together secretly with William H. Vanderbilt and Jay Gould to scheme against the public. They took oaths to cooperate while the public thought they were antagonists. And what about the Rockefeller-Rothschild feud? And why did John Archbold, John D. Rockefeller's right-hand man, go overseas and secretly work out business arrangements with the Rothschilds in the 1880s? One CIA agent described the company as a worn-out horror who needs to come in off the street and get cleaned. The Illuminati have made the CIA and used it for their own ends, and have let the CIA be the fall guy. When we start looking closer at the CIA, we see men like Archie Roosevelt of the Roosevelt family, who was a leader in the CIA, going to places such as Nigeria to visit the Emir of Kano with David Rockefeller. This Rockefeller/Roosevelt visit to the Emir was close to going to Timbuktu. David Rockefeller took along his own private professor of Egyptology when he went to the pyramids and to Egypt. Perhaps his love for Egypt relates to David's fixation and love for Beatles. Another aside, is that America's foremost Egyptologist Dr. Charles Breasted was underwritten by the Rockefellers. But then those few who understand the one-to-one correspondence of the Book of the Dead's rituals and modern satanic rituals might not be surprised. Nelson Rockefeller was part of the National Security Council, which sits even higher than the CIA in intelligence affairs. Speaking of far-off places, what about Miss Osman Ali Khan, who was the principal Muslim ruler of India at one time? And what about the multi-millionaire possible billionaire A.G.A. Khan Il? These men interacted socially with the Illuminati families. And how far does the Rockefeller wealth go? We know that through the Chase Investment Corporation they have such far-off holdings as a steel mill in Turkey, and a cotton textile mill in Nigeria. Creole Petroleum of Venezuela is owned by Nelson. Chase Manhattan has a full-time envoy to the UN and the Secretary Generals of the UN visit the Rockefellers at their estate at Pocantico. A number of families threw themselves in with the Rockefellers and owe their family wealth to the fact that they served the Rockefellers. These include John D. Archbold, the Harknesses, the Bedfords, the Chesebrews, the Cutlers, the Flaglers, the Folgers, the Paines, the Pierces, and the Rogerses. The Rockefellers have had a number of senators who he owns. In 1904, Senator Penrose received $25,000 and Senator Bliss received $100,000 given via Rockefeller's Standard Oil. One scholar wrote against the Rockefeller control of politics, the Standard Oil had done everything to the Pennsylvania legislature except refine it. Henry Demarest Lloyd, Wealth Against the Commonwealth. When the Rockefellers wanted to build a highway, they would summon people like Interior Secretary Stuart Udall to Nelson's apartment, where he talked Udall into permitting the Rockefellers to build an unpopular highway. In 1968, Hubert Humphrey wanted both David and Nelson Rockefeller in his cabinet. The Rockefellers cooked up the idea to have a World Trade Center in New York, and their cronies were involved in the scandal to promote the idea. David wrote letters of advice to President J.F. Kennedy. Where do all these elite connections end? All these top 13 Illuminati families tie together at the Feast of the Beast rituals. In addition to this grand meeting, where Satan puts in his personal appearance, these families have smaller meetings and rituals frequently all over the world. Their Council of Nine and their Council of 13 meet and send out their orders regularly. Volume 2 will examine how the Illuminati rule, what their organizations are, and what their life and rituals are like. An appendix, so to speak. As I failed to provide a genealogical chart for the Rockefeller family while doing my newsletter articles, I will as an appendix add that to this page. One of the families that intermarried with the Costellos was the Van Dyne family. But who are the Costellos? Frank Costello, died 1973, was the underworld boss of New York for many years until Vito Genovese, died 69, took control. Carlo Gambino took over from Vito until his death, and then in 1976 Carlo in turn died, and his heir Paul Castellano with some of the Gambino family took over. Now Roosevelt, Rosie or Rose, Gambino runs the Gambino family. The Ambino family is related in marriage to the Eli Lilly Illuminati family. Frank Costello had Jerry Catena working for him, and Eddie Torres was a close friend of Jerry Catena. Eddie Torres was the president of the Las Vegas Casino Riviera, before Gus Greenbaum took over. Greenbaum was connected to all the mafia, and was a casino manager for Meyer Lansky in Havana and other places. Lou Costello's father was from Italy. In Italy the name was spelled Cristillo. Lou Costello got Dean Martin into show business. Lou provided Dean Martin the money for his nose job before Dean made it big in show business. Lou's daughter later married Dean's son. Lou Pirri and Costello both got Dean Martin into show business. Costello had great clout with MCA. Costello got disgusted with Dean Martin in 1945 when Dean ran up bills which he charged to Lou Costello. Later Dean ignored Lou at a casino and also got Lou Costello ticked off. Dean's first wife was Betty McDonald. Betty's father was Bill McDonald. See what I've written on the McDonald's role in the Illuminati. Betty McDonald Martin became known for being a party-throwing alcoholic while neglecting her children. Carol Costello married Dean Martin's oldest son. One of Lou Costello's friends was Mickey Cohen. Frank Costello rubbed shoulders with the Rockefellers, with Lucky Luciano, and other powerful underworld figures. Costello controlled New York Mayor William Zero Dwyer. Frank Costello was also the owner of Alliance Distributors, who are the sole American distributors for Whiteley Company of Scotland. Scotch drinkers like the Orange Brown Scotch of the famous King's Ransom Scotch as well as the House of Lords Scotch. They may not realize that Costello was the sole distributor of these drinks, which were imported through him from Scotland. Ray Ryan, a young Texas oil tycoon, went into at least one petroleum lease venture with Frank Costello and Frank Erickson. Ray Ryan was friends also with Dean Martin. Ray Ryan was the godfather for Richie Martin. His Mount Kenya Safari Club had an elusive membership, including such Illuminati members as Winston Churchill and Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. Ray Ryan was involved with the militia when someone blew his Lincoln Continental up. The blast had been so powerful part of Palm Springs had its power knocked out. Dean Martin, Frank Sinatra, Sammy Davis, Jr., Peter Lawford, and Joey Bishop were known as the Rat Pack. All of these men were connected to the Mafia and some, if them were Satanists such as Sammy Davis, Jr., and Peter Lawford. In 1960, these men posed together outside of the Sands Casino for a picture where they performed together. This picture of the Rat Pack is in the book Dino. Living High in the Dirty Business of Dreams by Nick Toshes. Another picture of Dean Martin taken around 1954 shows him with Marilyn Monroe and Averell Harriman. Averell Harriman was in the Illuminati. Marilyn Monroe was a monarch sexual slave for the elite. Marilyn was a presidential model sexual slave for JFK. JFK was part of the Kennedy Illuminati family and he often spent time with members of the Rat Pack. The Hollywood Reporter described Dean Martin as a hypnotically attractive, homegrown American monster. Frank Sinatra was a very cruel man too. Dean Martin, Dino Crocetti, grew up in Steubenville, which was known for its gambling and prostitution. A white slavery ring that kidnapped beautiful women for whorehouses was headquartered in Steubenville. James Vincent Tripodi of the Mafia ran Steubenville. A popular saying in Steubenville among the youth was learn to steal, learn to deal, or go to the mill. Dino became a dealer at the Rex in Steubenville, run by Cosmo Quattroni. Jerry Lewis, a close associate to Dean Martin said, no one ever got to know him, not even Betty his wife. Herman Hover, who lived at 606 North Bedford Drive in Beverly Hills, bought his mansion from the Vanderbilts. Howard Hughes did a lot of his business at the mansion. Mickey Cohen, General J. Wainwright, Howard Hughes, James Roosevelt, FDR's son, and many other prominent people would go to Hover Ciro nightclub. Later they would go over to Hover's mansion. The mansion was a place of frequent parties that Dean Martin and others of his group would go to. In defiance of NBC's standards, Dean Martin for his Dean Martin show was going to show off women trained as animals. Dean Martin would walk on the show with a voluptuous gal in a tiger outfit on a leash that Dean would hold. The girl would then be telling Dean at every chance that she was not a girl but a fellow. When Dean married Kathy Hahn, in 1973, Frank Sinatra was his best man. Frank received a diamond-studded golden cigarette lighter with an obscene inscription. Dean worked many years for MGM Grand, which now is built as a pyramid in Las Vegas with monarch programming going on in it. The theme inside the MGM is the Wizard of Oz, which is for monarch programming. To understand the Wizard of Oz mind control programming, the reader needs to get this author's various writings on the monarch programming, which includes an illustrated guide to monarch programming and other writings. Bob Hope, an MI6 agent who was used extensively in World War II to trigger mind-controlled military men with the proper hypnotically embedded trigger words, received his own mind-controlled sex slaves after the war. One of these slaves of Bob Hope also worked for the Illuminati's Council of Seven. This author, Fritz Springmeier, knows her, and she is one of the few Illuminati slaves who has been deprogrammed. While she was a slave for Bob Hope, he loaned her to Sammy Davis, Jr., Dean Martin, and Richard Nixon to name a few. More about this monarch slave, which was used as a courier and a sexual slave, shortly. Let's explain some about Bob Hope. Because the previous paragraph may present the reader some difficulties, let's temporarily digress into the entertainment field's connections to the elite. The Caesars and the medieval kings recognized the importance of controlling the people with entertainment. The occult world has long been connected with entertainment. During World War II, the US and UK used almost everyone in the entertainment fields to help with the war effort. There have been numerous connections in this author's research about the Illuminati/CIA mind control, which connects back to the USO. The American military entertainers that traveled in USO units on tours. The story about how the USO was used to carry messages to mind-controlled agents and military men would include many names, including Quint Reynolds, Bruce Cabot, Joey Brown, Andy Devine, Candy Jones, Jessica Wilcox, and some many lesser known such as Wheeler, who later became known as the programmer Dr. Black. The military apparently was already using programmed killers to carry out deadly assignments. Bob Hope and the USO was used to carry trigger words to these mind-controlled people. For many years, the world's experts in running spies, the British Empire under the control of the Illuminati, have been using certain professions for spying. For instance, postmaster generals are used for spying because they can control the secret spying on mail. An example of this, Benjamin Franklin, postmaster general for the colonies, was an important spy for the Illuminati's British trading company/British government in the colonies. To understand his role in the Illuminati contrived American Revolution, read Chap. 3.4 in My BYs as Serpents. Likewise, what better person to pick than Bob Hope to run messages worldwide? Bob Hope was British, and MI6 knew they could trust him. Bob Hope has an excellent ability to learn and say lines. Bob was and still is great with words, knowing how to fit them together and to make puns and double and triple meaning sentences. His ability to construct sentences with double meanings was a great cover for the hidden messages he transmitted for Allied intelligence during the war. If you want to keep a secret, the best place is out in the open. The British and American intelligence agencies know this. Some of their greatest secrets are out in the open, where no one suspects what they are. Bob Hope, who was already a radio and movie star before World War II, was given wide publicity as he traveled all over for the USO. The entertainment groups for the military. Bob Hope was just an entertainer, and yet he visited Roosevelt, Churchill, Eisenhower, Patton, and all kinds of military men. Bob traveled all over the world to every front during the war, including England, Africa, the South Pacific, the east and west coasts of the U.S., the Caribbean, Panama, etc. He could fit all kinds of signals into his jokes and talks, and no one would be the wiser. Under the disguise of building moral by being a comedian, Bob could go anywhere, and because he always was making jokes, no one took him seriously. Bob Hope was a courier, a message bearer of coded messages. Sometimes the coded messages almost seem to jump out when you look at his wartime talks. MI6 and Mrs. Section BIA, under the supervision of London's W Board and 20 Committee, oversaw the running of double agents and mind-controlled couriers and mind-controlled spies. Special Intelligence Service, SIS, for the British dealt a great deal with mind control of all types. Tavistock Institute of Human Relations was part of SIS's mind control capabilities. Men like Tavistock's hypnotist/mind-control expert Eric Trist were willing to perform mind-control on British civilian/military men. Over the last 45 years, perhaps the most popular place for couriers to be signaled to meet was by someone holding a bird in a cage or at a shop with bird cages. The allusion to carrier pigeons is so obvious. Look at a caption speaking of wrens with a cartoon from Bob Hope's book I Never Left Home, New York, Simon & Schuster, 1944, written in 1944 during the middle of World War II. The cartoon shows Bob chasing a girl with a birdcage and saying tweet, tweet, tweet. Hypnotic commands are given 3 times. What seems like a harmless cartoon looks more like a signal telling people that Bob Hope is in charge of a flock of carrier pigeons, couriers. When talking to a group of soldiers during the war, Bob said, "In London, the Bobbies caught a guy walking around in the fog with a birdcage giving the mating call, but the American consul got me." There is a great deal more that could be written, perhaps books, but Americans need to understand that MI6, British intelligence, started, trained, and still control American intelligence. Remember that Canada entered World War II along with Britain, and the British set up one of their best secret agent training schools between Whitley and Oshawa, Ontario, in a place called Intrepid Park. The agents called it the camp or the farm. Now the CIA has their own camp or farm, which is Camp Peary, where they carry out mind control. The British named this British Security Coordination Special Training School No. 103 and Hydra. STS 11, 3. Some people called it Camp X. When the war broke out, the American FBI, OSS, SO, CIS, BSC, and the Canadian RCMP all sent people to be trained at the secret Camp X hidden on Lake Ontario's north shore across from the US-Canadian border. British SO, Special Operations Executive, set itself up for business in New York City, and during WW II directed operations from there. Let's get back to explaining about Frank Sinatra, a man who spent time visiting with the Rockefellers, the European and American Rothschilds, and other powerful figures including Bob Hope. Frank Sinatra, who is well known worldwide for his cruelty, would serve as the handler for Bob Hope's mind-controlled slave, S., when she sexually serviced men in the Rat Pack. In other words, Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin knew the cues, the trigger code words to get the slave to sexually serve them, especially Frank. Because Dean knew about the Monarch programming, that is why he had the audacity to want to bring a slave on his show on a leash in a tiger outfit. During the obedience training of a sexual slave, they have an expensive collar put on them, and their mind control programming for all sexual alters from infancy up is that they are cats. These slaves have cat alters, personalities, who are spin kitten alters. When Dean Martin, as an older man, would sexually get younger women like Andre Boyer, a 19-year-old student at UCLA, there is a good chance that Andre and others like her were under mind control. Frank Sinatra's parents were Natalie, Dolly, Della Gravanti from Genoa and Anthony Martin Sinatra from Catania, Sicily. His mother was a cigar-smoking, cruel, foul-mouthed woman. Dolly was a midwife and abortionist, before it was legal. Dolly didn't always escape legal detection for her illegal abortions. Just one of the times she was hauled into court was on February 27, 39 in a Hudson Special Sessions Court. Frank's parents always had money, and so Frank grew up as a child who always had money. He would share it with other kids, if they would be his friend. Frank was known as a lazy and mean boy as he grew up. He still did not have a steady job by the age of 20 and was still living off his parents. Frank's mother then decided to get him into singing. Due to his mother, Frank got some singing jobs and started going somewhere in life. After struggling for years, Tommy Dorsey got Frank Sinatra on the road to success with his band. Tommy Dorsey and Frank's mother got along great. Frank Sinatra wanted to emulate Benjamin Bugsy Siegel, who was boss of Nyerter, Inc. Let's digress for a minute and explain that the Illuminati will use the Mafia for murders which don't have formal approval of the Illuminati hierarchy to carry out. About 30% of the dirty work for the Illuminati is carried out by the Mafia. The Illuminati have their own death squads which are superior to the Mafia, but individuals must approach one of the councils for approval to assassinate. Often it's easier for those in the Illuminati just to put an unauthorized contract out on someone. The Mafia are often willing to make a business deal. The Mafia are intertwined with the occult, and some of the Mafia are involved in rituals, mind control programming, etc. However, there are a number of Mafia who are only in it for the business end, like many in the Yakuza. They are appalled at the heartless things that the Illuminati are doing, such as turning a whole generation of young people into drug addicts, etc. Some of the Mafia have much higher codes of honor than the generational Satanists. Frank Sinatra's hero Bugsy was associated with all the Mafia heads, such as Charlie Lucky Luciano, who controlled Marilyn Monroe as a slave, and Frank Costello. The New Jersey underworld kingpin Willie Moretti, aka Willie Moore, was Frank Sinatra's neighbor in Hasbrouck Heights. Bugsy was a cruel man. Frank was in total awe of Bugsy, almost enthralled to the point of worship. The Illuminati turned to Bugsy and then later to the Gambino family when they needed someone killed. Later, Bugsy got on the bad side of other Mafia chiefs and was killed by them. Frank Sinatra had a quick way of alienating people with his controlling anger. Frank alienated William Randolph Hearst, Jr. at a party by fighting with him. The Hearst papers started giving Frank bad publicity after the fight. Frank's agent and friend George Evans flew to Hollywood and threw Marion Davies, who was William Randolph Hearst's mistress for many years, he was able to get in to see the old man William Randolph Hearst, Sr., who was ill. Frank was properly contrite and got the old man to like him. Apparently with Marion Davis and the old man Hearst on his side, Frank was able to overcome the son's orders to the Hearst papers to give Frank negative publicity. After his visit with Marion and Hearst, Sr., Frank began to get positive publicity again. For those who need to be reminded, the Hearst family is an Illuminati family, and the Hearst Castle in California, which is owned by the state of California as a park, continues to be used for rituals for the Illuminati hierarchy. Of special note is that Marion Davis was connected to the Van Cleve family, which is another family which has intermarried with the Van Dyne family along with the Costellos. In case the reader missed it in a previous article, a prominent member of the Van Dyne family who headed California's Teen Challenge helped get Billy Graham's ministry started. This person is a member of the Illuminati as well as being a Christian minister. I am intentionally not mentioning his name. William Randolph Hearst paid for the first 3 years of Billy Graham's ministry. There are a number of people of the Van Dyne bloodline in the Illuminati who are also Christian ministers. I can't give my sources, needless to say they are several people who have been escaping the Illuminati. In the final analysis, we can say that several Illuminati members of the Van Dyne bloodline helped in the establishment of Billy Graham having a big crusade ministry. Frank Sinatra rubbed shoulders with many of the Illuminati. That doesn't mean that he was a member, it is possible that his mafia ties are why he was so well received by Illuminati kingpins. The Illuminati has a history of sharing their mind-controlled slaves with the mafia, even slaves who are members within the Illuminati are shared. However, the Illuminati always ensures that they have final control over a slave's programming. One of the people who was a drummer with the Tommy Dorsey band for a while was William Joseph Bryan, J.R., a.k.a. William Joseph Bryan, and William Jennings Bryan III, etc. William Joseph Bryan, Jr. was a CIA mind control programmer. He programmed people when he was with the Air Force as Chief of Medical Survival Training, which was a covert brainwashing section, if the Air Force. Bryan opened up his own hypnotherapy institute on Sunset Strip in Hollywood, where he programmed some people in acting for the Illuminati. Bryan was the person who programmed Sirhan Sirhan to kill Robert Kennedy. He also hypnotized Albert DiSalvo. After Bryan died in spring, 1977, the CIA cleaned out all of his files, including his home files. Bryan was a 6½-foot fat satanic priest in the old Roman Catholic Church. The CIA and the Illuminati have connections in this offshoot of Catholicism. Bryan was a descendant of William Jennings Bryan, the Mason who supposedly defended the creation view in the Scopes monkey evolution trial. W.J. Bryan, the third, or junior, was a frequent guest in many fundamentalist churches in Southern California. It's interesting how the Tommy Dorsey band had both Bryan and Sinatra in it, since both men would go on to be involved with satanic mind control in the future. William J. Bryan spoke to many judges, so it is possible he used his law degree to get him appointments with dirty judges that needed training about the Illuminati's mind control program. In William J. Bryan, Jr.'s book entitled The Chosen One: The Art of Jury Selection, Bryan teaches how to use hypnosis on jury members to win one's case. On the back of the book, the author is described, in addition, Dr. Bryan served as an electronics engineer in the Navy in World War II, was director of all medical survival training for the United States Air Force, and a leading expert on brainwashing. William J. Bryan was the technical director for Frank Sinatra's movie Manchurian Candidate, which is a film which was used to scare Americans into thinking the enemy was carrying out mind control. This was so that if the Illuminati CIA horrible trauma-based mind control was ever discovered, that the CIA would be justified in the minds of Americans for the horrible things they were doing. Illuminati mind-controlled slaves were forced to watch the movie Manchurian Candidate to further enhance their feelings of helplessness. Frank Sinatra made the movie by getting the rights from the book's author for the story. The author had, as far as I know, only stumbled upon what the Illuminati and their intelligence agencies were doing. Frank Sinatra squelched the second release of the Manchurian Candidate film, So it is clear that the entire movie was an affair carried out by the CIA to squelch the true story and to intimidate those thousands of mind-controlled slaves that they'd created. This article has elaborated on the Costello family and the Van Cleve family, which are branches of the Van Dynes. Interestingly, the elite Bohemian Grove, which has been used as a site for satanic rituals for over 25 years, has Joseph V. Costello, Jr., and Peter Van Cleve as members. Peter Van Cleve stayed in the bungalow called Ounce when he was at the Bohemian Grove. Several Illuminati survivors have indicated that the Van Dynes have power in California. If the Van Dynes family power is via the Costellos and Van Cleves and other unmentioned offshoots of the family, then finally the secrecy protecting the powerful Van Dyne satanic bloodline may be cracking for the first time. The Van Dyne family have changed the spelling on their name. One group spells it Van Dyne. Vance Van Dyne is an important NWO figure who graduated from Yale. He is an Episcopalian, and has worked with the big international bankers. He was born in San Francisco, but lived in New York City area. He has been on the board of director of the German-connected Vereinsbank Capital Corporation. Another Van Dyne of note is Harold Foster Van Dyne, Jr., who has been a famous architect. He has been a major figure in the Troy, MI company of Straub, Van Dyne and Associates. Bloodlines of Illuminati. The Merovingian Bloodline. This page has been prepared to provide some type of table of contents to the various items which will be included in this chapter, the 13th Satanic Bloodline. In my writings, this bloodline has been interwoven into the text of many articles, but it hasn't been singled out very much. Although a great deal has been written by this author on this final family, to pull out articles which concentrate on it solely is difficult. After assembling some pages on it, a few words of explanation were still needed. Allow me to briefly explain those items which were selected. An article on the top family that appeared in February 95 newsletter on page 73. An appendix to the Be Wise as Serpents book about the British royalty. The British royalty are tied in with the 13th bloodline. Many of the American political leaders have been related to the British royalty, including George Bush and Dan Quayle. A flyer from a Christian conference is included showing who the speakers are. Finally, a little of the genealogical information I assembled on the Mormon legend is given. This was included in the Be Wise as Serpents book to give people an idea of how the Mormon legend hip ties back in with the leading occult bloodlines of the Merovingian dynasty. The chart for LDS President Albert Smith is only about one-third typed out. The remainder of Albert Smith's, as well as other Mormon legend, genealogical work is in a file in some unknown box at my house. This bloodline is harder to track because it weaves in and out of the other 12 bloodlines. There are many surnames which are part of this bloodline, including the Smith family, however I can give one very prominent one, the Sinclair family. We know that Satan is the father of all lies, and Christ told the religions leaden who went out to destroy him that they were from the seed of Satan. Second feature article, the 13th Illuminati Bloodline. The 13th Illuminati Bloodline is where the Antichrist will come from. This bloodline believes that it has both the holy blood of Jesus and the blood, or seed, of Satan in its bloodline. In my Be Wise as Serpents book, I make reference to this bloodline, but I never really took the time to explain it completely. In fact, I don't fully understand this bloodline myself. I encourage those who want to learn more about this bloodline to study the following books. Holy Blood, Holy Grail by Lincoln, Lee, and Balgent, The Messianic Legacy. The Temple and the Lodge. Crusaders of the Grail by J.R. Church. The Antichrist King Juan Carlos by Dr. Charles R. Taylor. This bloodline is so extensive in its many branches that its membership takes in many of the presidents of the United States, including George Hush and George Washington. The reason that I gave the genealogies of the sum of the Mormon presidents to people back in 1991 in my Be Wise as Serpents book is that all of the Mormon presidents in history, whether are LDS or LDS, trace their blood back to this 13th bloodline. Within the Illuminati rituals, the emphasis of the 13th bloodline is that they are the seed of Satan. As their secret story goes, they are the direct descendants of Jesus's spiritual brother Lucifer. Since the Freeman family and the Rothschild family have members who are also in the 13th bloodline, it is unclear to me how interwoven the seed of Satan is. Some of the eerielest attempts to trace the seed of Satan were some books which did extensive research on the tribe of Dan and the descendants of Cain. The Curse of Canaan is an interesting book along with its mate World Order by Eustace Mullins. One of the books which I looked with difficulty for before finding it, was Gerald Massey's A Book of the Beginning, Secaucus, New Jersey, University Books, Inc., 1974. The book goes in and shows in detail how the inhabitants of the British Isles came originally from Egypt. This is important because, as this newsletter has always contended, the Druidism of the British Isles was simply a derivative from the Egyptian satanic witchcraft/magic of ancient Egypt. The Egyptian word Makhod, clan or family, became the Irish Macu and the Macu of the Donalds, clan of Donalds, now reflected in the name MacDonald. The sacred keepers of the clan stone in Erin, were also known by the family name of Clanchattans. Another word for clan is Mac and the Clanchattans were also known as Mac and Tush. Tariq, the name of the Egyptian god Ta, was passed down to us by the Druids adopting the name Patrick, which sounded similar. St. Patrick's Day then is a Christianized form of a Druidic holiday which originally had its origins in Egypt. The all-seeing eye can be found on ancient buildings in ancient Chaldea, in ancient Greece, and in ancient Egypt. The me-seeing eye represents Osiris. Osiris had debauched revelries, saturulias, celebrated in his honor. The temples in Arabia clear back in the time that Moses had his black father-in-law Jethro used the all-seeing eye to represent the false satanic trinity of Osiris, Isis, and Horus of Egypt. This me-seeing eye pops up everywhere the Illuminati has been. In the Winter Palace Square in St. Petersburg, Russia is that Illuminati all-seeing eye on top of a pyramid. You will also see it in the old Mexican Senate building which is now a museum in Mexico City. You will find this on the back of our $1 bill, and you will find the all-seeing eye was placed on Ethiopian stamps when they got a communist government in power. The Illuminati is the continuation of the mystery religions of Babylon and Egypt. And the bloodlines of the Illuminati go back to people who at one time lived in Babylon and Egypt. Just how the House of David, the Satanic One, and the holy blood of the 13th family fit in with everything else in history I can't say. I'm sure it would be a big story to tell if I knew. But I do feel that somehow the 13th Illuminati family does goes back to ancient times. Is this via the tribe of Dan or via some druidic bloodline or is it via the Merovingians or is it via all three and where do the Guelphs and black nobility fit into this? Whatever the case, the 13th bloodline has amassed a great deal of power and wealth on this planet. The 13th bloodline lacks nothing to bring forth their Antichrist who will appear to have all the correct credentials. I would not even be surprised if their Antichrist in order to appear real will expose another Antichrist. The 13th bloodline has kept its genealogies very secret. I would welcome more input from informed persons about this bloodline. The tribe of Dan was prophesied to be the black sheep of the nation of Israel which would bite the other tribes of Israel. The tribe of Dan had the snake and the eagle as its two logos. The tribe of Dan left its calling card all over Europe as it migrated west in the names of many places. The tribe of Dan ruled the Greeks, the Roman Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire and many others which used the eagle as its logo. Great Britain is the mother country of Satanism. 1. Scotland has long been an occult center. The national symbol of Scotland is the dragon, the snake, and for years the chief of Scotland was called the dragon. The Gaelic language is an important language for Satanism, although English and French are also used extensively by the Illuminati. The planning sessions for world takeover that some ex-Satanists experienced were held in French. The British royal family have long been involved with the occult. For more information on this, there is a detailed examination of the royal family and the occult in the book The Prince and the Paranormal: The Psychic Bloodline of the Royal Family by John Dale, 1987. 2. They have also been actively involved with Freemasonry. See the chart. British. MI6 has been a major vehicle for the satanic hierarchy working behind the secret veil of Freemasonry to control world events. 3. British MI6 is the most secret intelligence organization in the world. 4. It is properly known as British Secret Service, not to be confused with the US agency by that name but performing a different function entirely. The British royalty have served as important figureheads to British Freemasonry, lending credibility and respectability. British Freemasonry has managed to keep itself free of much of the criticism that the other national Masonic groups have brought on themselves. However, much of the credibility of British Freemasonry is undeserved. True, British Freemasonry is what it portrays itself to the public for the lower levels. But, the lower level Masons by their dues and activities are unwittingly supporting an organization that is led by Satanists at the top. An example of the subterfuge constantly exercised on the public by Freemasonry is a book purportedly written by a non-Mason entitled The Unlocked Secret Freemasonry Examined. The book portrays itself as an unbiased and complete expose of Freemasonry. The book states unequivocally that the Masonic order called Societas Rosicrucian in Anglia, SIC, is only open to Christians and is a Christian order. However, Edith Starr Miller reprints copies of a number of letters from the chief of the Societas Rosicruciana in Anglia which show that the English Grand Masonic Lodge, the SRIA, the OTO, and the German Illuminati are all working together. 5. She briefly explains how she obtained the letters. Notes. 1. Interviews with numerous ex-witches and ex-Satanists. 2. Copies available from Barry House Christian Books, Klaus Topp, Kidderminster, Wars, DY149HX, England. 3. Confidential interviews. 4. Wise, David and Thomas B. Ross. The Espionage Establishment, page 79. 5. Miller, Occult Theocracy, appendix 4, pages 8-35.